I'm from ICER. My name is Ayush, and I am a second year student at ICER. ICER
Okay. Okay.
Mohali.
Okay. ICER Mohali. Abhirup, please respond to this.
Yeah. Hi. Hi, everyone. I'm Abhirup Chauhan. I'm currently in studying natural sciences at ICER Kolkata. I'm right now in second year of the college.
Okay. So Vamsi, how I think you can, you know, before we begin your presentation, maybe in a minute or so, you can just tell us about your brief journey from, let's say, your school to now.
Sure. Hello, everyone. Hi, Ayush. Hi, Abhirup. Hey. Thanks, Vishal, for giving me the opportunity to speak and present myself. I am Vamsi Krishna. Hey, Amit.
Atul,
sir. Sorry.
Hey, hi, Atul. Krishna. Hi, namaste.
Namaste. I was about to introduce myself. So I'm Vamsi Krishna, having graduated from IIT Kharagpur, BTech and Masters in 2006. I went to Microsoft and then moved to US, worked in some big firms such as Amazon and Chegg. And later I founded two of my own startups in US while having full-time jobs. They didn't go well, but I learned my own lessons and some experiences. Now I moved back to India and launched my own startup, which is a global matchmaking service, which is personalized. It's called Happily Ever After. So if you're looking, if you're finding hard to find a life partner, we will help you.
You work with Chegg. That's an online tutoring company, right? The one you referred to me also a few months back,
yeah.
Right?
Yes. So Chegg does a lot of things. Tutoring is just one of them. They have their own product portfolio. Their core business is textbook rentals for college kids, especially those in abroad. The college textbooks are very expensive, so and not all schools have good libraries. So you can rent out your all the whole course textbooks for the whole semester and then give it back after the semester is done. They used to make major chunk of their revenue from that.
How much is the difference in the cost? Like, let's say buying actual book versus
a lot, I think, especially college books, especially engineering or any degree books in US, probably with 1/10 of the cost of all the books, they can get the whole semester done and they'll give you books.
It's a good idea even for India, I think, you know, just doing this rental of books. I think people do that, sharing and all probably, and maybe buying secondhand books, but probably there is no centralized place which does this. You know, like just consider our, let's say, IIT 4-year, 5-year program, and we have some books, etc., right? I guess, you know, like, let's say Kharagpur can have a store which can do something like Chegg, or, I mean, so there can be some local, or, I mean, they can target maybe specific colleges or something. A Me Too startup might work here, actually. It's a good idea.
Yep.
There are like just books, and there are a few other similar startups in India, I think.
Okay, sure. So maybe our time it was not there. Okay, so Vamsi, please let me make you the co-host. So, okay. I think can you share? Try sharing from your side.
No. Host disabled.
Okay. Just a sec. Let me do that.
We can't hear you.
try now?
No. Yep, it's working. Let me share. Can you see my screen?
Yes, yes.
Cool. So before I present, let me share the agenda. Vishal suggested it's a good platform where we can just share the problems we faced and how we try to solve them. And that would be my main agenda here. I'll just explain briefly about our journey so far in our own startup and some of the challenges and problems we had and how we so far managed to...
Can everybody else hear the audio? I can't hear the audio.
Is it audible?
Yes, I can hear.
Yes.
Maybe Atul sir, you can try exiting and joining. Sometimes audio doesn't connect very well. Vamsi, please continue.
Yeah. So our company, the legal name is Tortoise Creative. It has offices both in Mountain View, California and Hyderabad, India. Our core products so far has been, we call it Happily Ever After. It's a matchmaking service. We connect couples so that they are happy ever after. It's more like a matchmaking or a matrimony service. And our website is happilyever.co. We officially booted on December 9th. So it's almost been just above a month and a half. We have a much broader vision to bring a smile to every soul on the planet, especially those in distress, through bold, caring, and creative actions. And if you're curious why we call ourselves as Tortoise, it comes from the Hare and Tortoise story, where we want to be like tortoise, where we move slow, but very strategic, one step every day, then move fast and make wrong decisions. And that's where the bold, caring, and creative actions part comes here. And we want to start with the current mission of focusing on matchmaking, because there's a lot of singles out there in the world where they almost gave up or very tired of finding a life partner. Or even NRIs, they have a similar issue because NRIs, they are not very comfortable with the American dating apps or white man's, say, matchmaking personalized service. Neither do they like the current Shaadi.com or BharatMatrimony.com because of their various reasons. So we cater to that niche need, where either it's NRIs or singles anywhere in the India or global, doesn't necessarily need to be Indians, who are looking for a serious life partner, we help them. And that's our current mission. And the strategy is twofold. We have a personalized matchmaking service, which is slowly taking shape. So far we were like a baby rolling on the ground. Now we started to crawl. And we have a social initiative called Anxiety and Depression Initiative, called ADI, which is a platform for people who are depressed or anxious to come together as a self-help group, both offline and online. It's on last Sunday of every month. And that's both are global initiatives. And we have interest from India, US, and Europe so far. So the stage right now, we are in pre-seed. Most of our onboarding of customers and helping customers has been like a white glove service, where we don't have a web app ready. It's still cooking, but we do through Zoom, PDFs, Google Forms, of those sorts. And we're a very high touch at this point, and it will reduce over time once we have the web app in place. So we have 40 customers in pipeline so far. Pipeline in the sense, initially customers show interest, and then we try to schedule a call or they fill out a form, and we get a lot of deep insights about their personality, what they like, and also a lot deeper into who they are. There are some deep questions we ask and where they take their time to answer. And there are certain aspects around even audio, video, where customers share, and photos and ID, all that takes time to onboard people. But it's for a good reason, because we want to build trust, and we are almost like a data company, though our core focus is matchmaking for now. And we are a team of five so far, including me. If you have any questions, feel free to stop and ask. So these are some of the philosophy that the company follows, mostly coming from my own personality. So as a founder, I frequently keep thinking about what is the biggest risk today that I can think of for the company. It could be something around learning a customer, learning about behavior of a customer that I might not be aware of. Or it could be something is taking too slow, it's moving too slow. So it's usually one of these two things. And there are sometimes it's the issue is about money. But at a high level, I'm always thinking when I wake up, what is the biggest risk I want to focus on today? Second one is I'm a big believer of conducting experiments on a continuous basis, where each experiment reveals something about a customer behavior. The experiment could be on a product, or it could be on any touch point between the experiment, between the customer and us, where we are trying to learn something. Or prove or disprove a hypothesis that is related to our core strategy. And I strongly believe the length of the experiment cycle decides the success of your company. The smallest you can, and the small modular micro value you can add in the shortest period of time, that decides the how fast you can move, how quickly you can succeed. So I am constantly almost obsessed with keeping this length of each experiment very small. Which sometimes it includes hiring, sometimes it includes making existing operations smarter, and sometimes it includes deep analysis or planning for what do we want to figure out this time. And this could be in any department, it's not necessarily engineering. It could be in operations, it could be in UX, it could be in user experience, or it could be just some insight about the industry itself. And right now the metrics, we are not focusing on the number of customers or how fast we're onboarding as our core metrics. Metrics has been how fast you're learning about the customer behavior. And that will probably continue for another month or two. But in the back of our heads, we do have the total number of customers incoming every week as one of the secondary metric, but not that important at this point, because we're still shaping our product, understanding customers better, and trying to find where exactly we fit. This includes also trying to experiment with pricing and trying to see, give value to customers and confirm the customers feel the value and pricing match. Regarding big plans, we do discuss very rarely, maybe once in a while, where we want to be. Say, we have a very long-term vision and the midterm vision, but we spend probably 5% time on that. Most of the time goes into, I have 3 hours today. What can I do which can bring a micro value to the customer? And it doesn't need to be perfect, but we want to do something, put even something bad in front of the customer. At least we'll know that it's bad and also know what is actually good so that we can tweak and get better sooner and faster. It goes back to the length of the experiment cycle. At least I believe in do something quick, even if it's dirty, and then iterate and be very careful of how you expose to what customer. And that has been really helping, where this makes us very action results driven company. The next philosophy is about nothing is out of reach. What it means is, as a founder, you would have to focus on various departments. Sometimes you're being a marketing person, sometimes you're a salesperson, sometimes you are an engineering person, and sometimes you do accounting. There's nothing, no task that I believe should be out of reach for a founder. Because every task, I believe, no matter how much complex it is, it could be often be broken down into a sequence of small steps you need to do to get there. As long as you're good at it, I believe nothing is out of reach should be out of reach for a founder. And maybe at the end of the steps, you might realize that you failed, but at least you came to a conclusion that you failed. But just focusing on what those steps are will help us move ahead. And I'm very obsessed about also finding about my own blind spots about the company. What is that thing that we don't even know that exists out there that is actually hindering our progress? Which could be maybe a competitor is doing something, or the market is shifting, or people's thoughts are shifting, the trends are changing. Maybe our website, you think something, but customers are actually feeling something else. So I'm constantly in search for these blind spots because those reveal a lot of useful insights. And those reveal the reasons why you're failing, which will help us do something about it. And the last thing we also do is we try to do things that don't scale, especially if it helps in customer delight, which would mean we try to do, because we are a matchmaking business and we are a personalized matchmaking, most of the customers have a very deep relationship with us. They are all almost very emotional because our onboarding calls, people reveal so much that it makes us feel, blessed, or put at a very high responsible position. Because we know so well about them, we really want to give them good value and we give them a match. Because our matchmaking goes beyond statistical matching. We go on a few steps beyond. So this is the core philosophy together that summarizes what Tortoise Creative is all about. And so far it's been helping. We are seeing results. We are seeing surprises, sometimes good surprises where we don't expect such a response and we do get. We also have blind spots. So we are ready to shift our strategy any day, as long as we have strong data supporting it and we try to run an experiment to first prove or disprove it. So coming to the core crux of this, the whole agenda of this meeting, what are some of the problems we have been seeing? Fortunately, so far nothing has been unsolvable that I have been losing sleep. And every 2 days the problems change. The biggest problem changes every 2 days. And there's something we do on those next 2 days to make it less problematic, or we have a strategy for it, or we have an action item which proves or disproves that our strategy is right. So that's at least giving me good sleep. So here are some of the challenges we faced in various departments so far. On the product side, especially for a matchmaking site, the look is important. It's a B2C business. So people does care about the visuals and the user experience. And UX is pretty expensive. Because we are a small company, we can't afford to pay high salaries and get very experienced UX. So we're dealing with people, employees who are passionate and have some level of skill, but not like a perfect, like a senior person. So this makes us move a bit slower, but it's okay. So we found ways where it is not in our critical path. So another aspect has been around understanding the behavior of the customer at all touch points. So touch point is any time a customer is interacting with our company itself. It could be on our website, it could be on the product, or it could be when they're talking to one of our operations person, or it could be a receivable or something that customers can interact that we send to them over email. So all of them are touch points. And each touch points, we try to understand what exactly, does a customer like it or not? What does he not like it in this? Is there something he's not expressing? So trying to understand that and really getting to the heart of understanding their behavior and thought process has been a challenge. We're continuously learning and evolving. And each time we learn, we get better. It's been a good experience trying to do that. And it's a continuous process, understanding the customer mindset and behavior. The other set of challenges have been around operations. We can't afford a lot of senior members. Most of the people, most of the employees, most of our teammates are freshers, or someone who was in a completely different domain before, but are trying out something they're passionate about, which is in the current role. So fortunately, from my previous experience and contacts, I was able to get external consultants who are experts in their domain. This includes front-end, back-end, DevOps, marketing, an overall company strategy. So I have 5 different consultants, all of them in my friends before, who are helping our existing team and me trying to make the right decisions, especially those that need a lot of experience in that domain. And we feel blessed to have that network. And the ROC model is all about smooth operations. What it essentially means, at any given point of time, there's a concept called scaling down, scale down. It's all about improving the efficiency of an operating pipeline. And it's called a ROC because it comes from the story about dams. In a dam, which has 10 gates, if you open all the 10 gates, let's say the water flows only at a particular rate, it cannot go any faster than that. So if you have a huge cyclone, sorry, a huge storm, a lot of water comes in, the dam might fail because even all the 10 gates may not be enough. So what do you do at those times? So there's a concept called a ROC model. What the dam does is, let's say they only, when there's no high load, much ahead of time, they open just one gate and let the water pass by. When one gate passes by, there's often, you would see the largest ROC that you can see in the pathway in the system. What people do is they remove that ROC. They kind of cut it or chop it or blast it. So that's kind of hindering the flow. Once you remove it, now when you just open one gate, the water flows faster. So it's still one gate. And let's say you remove that rock, the water just feels flat. So you won't know what happens. So then they just open half the gate. And then you will see the next biggest rock. It could be somewhere else. So essentially what it means is, in the whole operation pipeline, which starts from getting a customer lead till we make the customer happy, we are constantly looking at what is the biggest rock, where is the maximum time and complexity going, and then we'll just focus on how do you make it smarter, how do you make it evaporate, or how do you make it much lesser. Once that happens, then we let the flow happen for a few more customers, and then find what is the next rock. So this way, we have been trying to reduce amount of time it takes to onboard a customer. It also is helping us increase our customer delight by more than 1x. And one challenge so far has been my work-life balance. Till my dad told me yesterday that I'm not even getting time to talk to him, I just realized, yes, I'm suffering from the founder regular problem that not having enough time to spend with family. So I've been chewing on this. So I realized that if we had more experienced people in the company to handle some of these operations, I won't have the need to sit with each teammate and then make help in their work. So slowly, I still don't know how to get there, but at least I know that this is the number of hours I ideally want to work. And I need to either operational efficiency or training the existing high potential people to become managers, or hiring is the only way to do it. So far I could think of, and it'll probably take a few more weeks, if not 2-3 months, for me to get there. And right now, the biggest, as I said, I'm always thinking about the biggest risk. The biggest risk so far, as of today, it's not going to the next page, Vishal.
It's not going to the next page.
Okay. Yeah.
I think there's a slight lag, probably.
Yeah. I think the biggest risk so far for the company has been not having enough marketing muscle, because it's matchmaking. And there's so much competition out there, and we haven't spent any money for marketing. The only marketing we have done is my WhatsApp, my LinkedIn, and my Facebook. And now same with the operations guy, we haven't done anything beyond that. So we plan to soon put more emphasis on this for the next few months, at least for the next month, till we see more inflow coming in, because it's a two-sided platform company. Now you will only see value when the numbers increase, and when we can find a match for a given person in a larger group of people who join in. So far our focus has been, how do even with the existing small set, can we make them happy? We are very close to being there, and soon once we nailed it, where we know that we can at least do a good job with at least existing set, and they're happy, then we want to open up the floodgates and go for very aggressive marketing, so that more people get to know about us. The challenge has been countries as well, because most of our customers have been abroad, in Europe, US. 35% are in India, but 65% are abroad. So that makes it slightly tricky, but it's not unsolvable again. And I think that's it. That summarizes.
Sure, that looks very interesting. I think I was also talking to someone today only on this relationship issues and all, so relates to that in some ways. So I have a question. I think others can ask after this. Probably let me ask the very first question at least. What is you said you have 40 customers or probable kind of your first set of people who are willing to try your product. So are these 40 people, what's the gender ratio of this 40 people as of now?
It's been luckily more or less equal. There are actually more women than men, if I had to put a number, maybe 70% women, 30%. Yeah, 70 women, 30 men.
Okay. So one more question then, this follow-up question. Are you willing to matchmake them with like this 40 people or whatever, let's say 4,000 people, let's say tomorrow you get, or 4 lakh people, are you going to use your own members to matchmake to each yes. other, or you yes. want to do it like a personalized, that you will go beyond the your members also, or is it like pretty much like a
it
community
marrying
with each other?
It is personalized, but it's within the network.
So that's the limitation as of now then.
Yes.
Even if you have, let's say, 70% female, 30% male, so there will be 40% male who will be still deprived as of, let's say, if I, even I...
It's even more than that. It's even more than that. Just because
so
we have 50 men, 50
females
women.
Females are, as of now, more... this is more of a problem for females as of now. In your experience?
Yeah. I think we have a bigger problem than that. Even if we have 50 men, 50 women, it doesn't mean all will match each other. In fact, most of our age group has been, customers have been between 30 to 43. And once you cross 30, especially if you're Indian, your set of requirements are actually a lot higher. You look for a lot deeper things. And
maybe
you're also less attractive.
Too many
parameters.
I see too many conditions will make the... So, in a very simpler word, people have so many conditions that there might be just, like a handful of people fitting that criteria across the world. And, reaching that niche is a very big problem in itself. And even if you reach that niche, square of a square kind of, a square root of a square root, something like that. Then matchmaking them and making both parties agree, because everyone might be saying, I need a like this. But then the person who have all those qualities may not be single at all. So do you see that as a potential problem? Yeah, and others can ask, please. I think I have asked a few questions now. Yeah, anyone else want to ask? Atul sir, you want to? Abhirup, yes, please.
Yeah, I want to ask, what are you doing to get the seed funds? This kind of ideas already exist. And so, how are you tackling the questions of investors?
So right now I'm funding it myself, and I'll probably continue to do it for another few months. Then I will think of seed funding, pre-seed funding.
Okay, so how much expenditure is still, how much you have invested in this?
So far, most of my expenses have been the four employees we have been, which is 60,000. So I pay 15,000 per each. And rest of it goes into DevOps and monthly expenses for some of the software services we bought.
Okay, so a burn rate of 1 lakh almost.
Okay, so that you have this team, you have hired this team, or all these are co-founders?
I've hired all of them. There's no co-founder. And intentionally, I didn't want to have one because I've seen enough companies suffer due to co-founder conflict. It doesn't mean it won't work, but I just don't want to take that risk. Unless, if there is one co-founder, they will naturally emerge in the people I'm hiring. And that's how I want to at least do it this time. And in my case, I'm a techie as well myself. And I have some experience with sales and marketing too. So I didn't find a dire need to have one. So I don't have one.
Okay.
So,
Atul, sir, please.
So I had two questions. Number one, immediately sprang up of the lack of co-founders. So for me, startup is all about having a team. And if I'm not able to convince my friends, family, alumni, whoever is a complimentary person to the team, so I would take that as a red flag that I've not been able to convince people about the idea. That's one. And the second question is, the marketplace is so crowded with so many dating apps, so many dating apps in India, in abroad, all over the world. So in that crowded space, why do you think people will try with it? What's so special about yours that others will even want to try that?
Yeah, it's a good question, Atul. Probably the first one is a statement, so I won't comment on that. The co-founder one, or was that a question itself?
Do you believe that? Probably Atul sir wants to ask that.
Yeah, exactly.
Not a team member or not a co-founder.
So, that's a good question. So the ops manager definitely does question me all the time. It helps me think deeper. And I have two advisors I meet once a month who themselves are, who know me before and are, have their own companies, who objectively poke me and make me think deeper. So at least I have them as my balance. And as long as the customers are coming in and they're happy, I'm good. And that's what I think about the first one. The second one, yes, our product right now doesn't cater to the all audience. There is a lot of competition. That's why we chose a very niche and we want to make that niche happy. And this niche is a set of people who are tired of dating or matrimony services, and you'll see a lot of them around you. And right now, NRIs, personalized matchmaking, has been something that is very rare, and that's definitely we are catering to it. And also singles who have given up on most dating and matrimony sites are our focus. And we are one of the reasons we also got into depression and anxiety initiative is we personally know and have seen many singles, especially above 30, who are depressed, especially in US and also women in India, but they have given up. They do not trust these sites, and they would love something like this, which is more focused on reducing their emotional pain and doing a good job at taking your time to find the right match. So we want to focus on that niche where they are not using most any other apps and want a personalized service. Then once we nail that target segment, then we at least have a footprint. Then we will think about how do you compete with the more general crowd.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else want to ask?
Good evening. Hello.
Yeah. Ditanshu, then Aman.
Okay. So hello. So hi. You have once said ki like you are like you are not able to like work and like family balance. You are not able to like do it like
manage
family and work balance. Manage your family and work balance. So if you get a co-founder, so don't you think with some operational experience and all, so don't you think it will be better for you to have one co-founder and like they can also manage along with you so that you can have like more time with your family?
Yes, you're probably true. You're probably right.
Then like, but you said ki like right now you are not like looking for any co-founder. So what's the main major reason you are like not like looking for any co-founder in your like in initial stage?
I haven't thought about that essentially, because
so I'm saying one, you said one, you know, like some cases where there was some conflict, right?
Yeah.
Co-founders, probably, you know, maybe if you can share a bit of that, if you want to build the identity, it's okay, but you can just share what conflicts you have seen, because you know we are always, I mean, just like this matrimony problem, it's always, you know, we are always surrounded by our experiences, and somehow we believe that, or we generalize those also. So please.
Yeah. I think I may be biased, I may be wrong, but at least I'm what I believe. I remember reading articles, which was about top, if you see for top 10 reasons why startups fail, the number one was product market fit, not having the right fit. Number two was co-founder conflict. And I wanted to just remove that risk by not having a co-founder. And secondly, I've seen my previous company where I worked in, become a unicorn called, I don't want to reveal its name, in security domain. The initial founder, after 5 years of putting his heart and soul out there, where he moved the company from zero till $60 million, he was kicked out by the board and another co-founder. And he now not part of the company. And he was the one who set all the product strategy. He was a visionary. And just happened because the investors who came on the board, they had a different vision than him. And the other co-founder was not convinced, so they let him out. And you can just read online, co-founder conflict. And when I read some articles saying only have a co-founder, actually I've talked to some advisors before I made this choice. So some of them said, can you manage without one? Then don't. I said, yes, I can manage without one. And that's why I didn't. Yes, if I get him, probably there might be work-life balance. But it also comes up with its own opportunity cost. I would have to now convince him. And he would have to convince me. And there's a communication happens. And any two humans, at some point of time, they will disagree. It's guaranteed.
Actually, you are solving that problem only. By your matchmaking, you know, it's a kind of a paradox.
Correct. So it's just my own personal thing. I believe one of my the ops manager can be a worthy co-founder. I'm closely watching him. Maybe in a year, if he works at the same pace he is, I would love to have him on board, because he proven it to me, and then it wasn't offered to me in a plate.
Vamsi, in your case, you know, I have a small advice for you. Do you have any female in your team as of now?
Yes.
You have?
Yeah.
So probably, you know, since you are dealing with this kind of male-female matchmaking, you will probably need, I mean, this is my gut feeling also, you will need a female face, you know, at a very senior level, I mean, your level or something, just to attract that female crowd, because females might not be very comfortable sharing everything, you know, with, I mean, or not comfortable just joining or being a member of a male-centric company. Probably. I'm not sure. Think about it. I think something which others can add or something. Naman, please.
So I would like to add to that, Vishalji, that not having a female co-founder, or especially in the team, the leadership team, that itself would be turn off for many members to join, and secondly also for any investors also to join. So not having a female co-founder and team definitely will be a big handicap in my view.
Yeah, so do think about it. I mean, just my two cents. Anyone else wants to ask or add something, please? Aman, you wanted to say something, please. Aman, are you there? Let me ask one more question, and if anyone else want to ask, Ujwal, you want to ask anything? Preeti, you want to say something? All good? Okay. So I think you had a problem of, mentioned problem of this marketing also, right? And I think when you're saying you will cater to NRIs, so it's probably one party is an NRI, the other party may be non-NRI also, or, you know, like someone who wants to get married to NRI or something. Broadly, it probably will be a male NRI trying to find a non-NRI female who can, you know, who they can get married in India, and later they can settle with the guy, maybe, or maybe the vice versa case might be there, but probably from my thinking, I think not too many. It might be more the male side. So you will need a heavy marketing for this, because what I also see is there are a lot of people, like if I talk about Canada, let's say, it's very Punjabi dominated. Singapore is very Tamil Nadu, Tamil dominated, right? So they would want...
Or Malayali somebody. Too, Malayali.
Yeah, Malayali. And Dubai, Malayali, yeah, Malayali. Yeah, whatever. I mean, some demographics is there. There's a majority, and then there are obviously Indians are everywhere. It's just about which state. So you might have to change your strategy of marketing depending on which location you cater to. So this will not be, like you said also, right, very personalized service, right? And in India, I think marriage is way complex than Western world, because marriage is seen as two family marrying each other, even though they can say whatever, but eventually, you know, at the core, everyone knows that people are emotional. They cannot just ignore their family. So it's eventually going to be two families marrying each other, and which makes things way complex than just a dating website where, you know, it's just one-on-one matchmaking. I like you, you like me, whatever. So did you see this as a problem, or, I mean, have you thought about this angle also, that things are more on the family-centric than very individualistic?
Yeah, the siblings, father, mother of every Indian who is in on our platform, we go very deep into knowing about them as well, at least through their mouth. And that goes into our actually matching algorithm too. Even in matching preferences, we ask a lot about what kind of family you want, not just job title, salary, about the other matches family, but even what kind of personality do you want, what kind of family do you want to get into, and what are your thoughts about if dowry is a point within that. At least that all is part of, so our matching algorithm is quite complex. And also, when you don't like a match, we take feedback from the person who is rejecting the match only to us. So that goes into the matching algorithm. So next time we'll try to not repeat that and give you something better. Mm-hmm. And even the looks, what does a guy look in a woman physically, and vice versa. Even that we are going deeper without offending any parties. We try to know more. So that when we're suggesting a match,
probably revealing the details. Offended points.
Yep.
But you know those offended point, or you will know slowly, you know, think of yourself as a AI kind of.
Yeah. So we'll be like the elder brother or sister of the match.
Both parties.
So that we know exactly what do they go for.
Yeah.
And it's very private information to us.
That's a good line to put as your pitch, that, you know, we are like your elder brother or like your father. Elder brother, I think better, probably father, maybe one generation gap. Maybe we are like your elder brother who will find the best match for you. Might go as your tagline or something like a marketing line. That's good. You also, I think, mentioned this work-life balance problem. So I think from my point of view also, like I also used to suffer that a lot, and now also I'm, it's not gone obviously, but it reduces with time, I'll say. Right now you are, you know, it's like kind of baby is born, right? So there is too much of problems, or I mean time management, etc. Once the baby gets a bit bigger, things will probably get more balanced rather than not so balanced. And I think that, like you started 1 or 2 months ago only, 1 month starting. I mean, you have already registered your company? Your voice is not coming. Yeah, once your voice is gone.
How about now?
Yeah, now it's okay.
Okay, okay. In US, yes, it's registered. In India, it's in progress.
So when you register, don't you need 2 directors or 2 people in US?
Yes. No, no, no. In US, you just need one. I mean, minimum one.
Or a private limited equivalent.
C Corp. Yeah, it's called Inc. usually. Okay. So we have Tortoise Creative Inc. And we recently bought the Tortoise Creative Private Limited name. And yeah. The CA team is working with the for registration.
Okay, sure. Atul sir, do you have any more comment suggestions for OMC, please?
No, so I already shared. Number one is that co-founder paid. Number two is the lack of female co-founders. And number three, market is so crowded. So even though Vamsi's plan is that we want to be in a very special niche group, but at the end of it, any entrepreneur, any startup which is not very, very scalable, might not survive for long. Yeah, you will either get eaten up, acquired, or have a merger, or something happens. It's very hard to survive as a small niche startup. I mean, there are like people run their own paan ka dukaan, chai ka dukaan, but I don't think that's what Vamsi is dreaming of, given his wonderful background experience. So I'm sure he would want to have a slightly bigger scale. So that's what I wanted to comment.
Yeah, Aman, you wanted to say something, please.
Yeah, hello, good evening to all of you. Namaste. So my first question is that what is the name of the company that you started? I'm a little late, so know about the few things that this is a basic dating app which is working after the age of 30, right? And targeting like 30 to 43. Okay, can I know basically the name of the company?
Happily Ever After.
What is Happily?
Maybe Happily Ever you can share the website on the screen, please. So that you know, we know, we get more of a feel of your product also.
Yep.
We have 10 minutes.
Yep. Give me a minute. So can you guys see the screen?
Yes, yes.
Yes, yes. We can see that.
So our product is, the brand name is Happily Ever After. The website is happilyever.co.
So this $13 is the upfront cost that everyone needs to pay?
No. No. So to onboard, it's free. To get matches, it's free. Only when you want to show interest on that person, you pay only for that person, $13. And if that person rejects you, you get $3 back.
So to show interest, which means basically share information with each other?
No, in order to talk.
Okay. So basically go to the next level. You want to interact or something.
Yep.
And then you guys try to have a Zoom call between those two.
So it depends on their both interests. If they are willing to share phone numbers, then we'll share each other's numbers. This is if there is a mutual match.
Okay. Or so if they, it's basically prefer... your you are making maximum, you'll make $13, not maximum, let's say per match you will make $13 if everything is okay, or rather $10, then let's say if they look for, kind of, you can say this, let's say if I take analogy of this as co-founders matchmaking, so for each potential co-founder meetup you will charge $10, so $10
yes
per lead,
yeah,
something like that.
And for the last one, which
there
works,
is a marriage happening, whatever,
yep.
So probably people will, I think in your case, go for 10, 20, maybe 50. Do you have, have you thought of any limit? How many matches should...
I think our gut feel is you might look at probably 5 matches and probably your 6th one will be the one.
Yeah. On average. So I think that will be your USP. How fast you get that... final conversion done. If it is a single digit, you will start to grow in that crowded area, because I think most of the dating apps and others, it's just too crowded, it's just too much spam to filter.
Sure,
that's good. Anyone else want to have a comment on the website? I don't know, maybe this color is too red. Maybe, what do you think, guys, other people, why you choose this red? like that?
No, I don't want to tell it. It should come naturally to you. If not, I'm not doing a good job.
And how many questions do you ask in this when somebody signs up?
No. We ask around 10 to 11, and then there'll be an agent call where the agent will onboard with more deeper questions. And usually the agent call goes for half an hour to 40 minutes.
Okay, so it's
as of now
basic membership, sign up, which is quick, 10 questions. And then there is like a follow-up call, knowing the person better. But then still it's free.
Yes, right? Yes.
So I guess this strategy will also work, because you are giving that personalized call right away, kind of a customer care call. So people will think, chalo ek to try karke dekhte hain, at least ek match.
Yep.
And then that very first match will determine if they are going to go for subsequent matches or not. Like, haan, theek hai, ye pehla to, it was okay. Or maybe just a mismatch in other things. They did a good job. So they'll say, okay, let's unveil few more matches.
Yep. So they'll have to wait. It's unlike other, because we don't have a lot of customers. It's not that as soon as you join, we'll give you one match. That only happens if you already have it. If not, we tell you that we got all your requirements. We don't have one yet, but we'll give you one. And anyway, you're not paying till we show you.
Yeah.
And even after show you, if you don't like, you won't pay anyway. But you will have to give feedback why you didn't like. So the next time we'll try to do better. But if you like and want to move ahead, then you start to pay.
Did you see this problem among your family, friends, like closed people? This matchmaking.
I think myself.
A lot of people.
Because I am.
So that can be your, part of your PPT also at the beginning. Why you're doing this? Because I myself suffered. That's why I'm doing it.
Yep. I should have mentioned that. Yep.
And that makes the story more convincing to people that, okay, it's my, scratching my own itch, kind of.
Yep.
Okay, sure. Anyone else have any comment or questions, please? Last 4 minutes. All good? Yep. Okay. Vamsi, thank you very much for your presentation, and I think we wish you all the best for your startup, and I think we'll probably I request everyone to have a look, a deeper look at the website, and see if something you can refer to people and give more feedback, and that's all for tonight. Thank you everyone. for coming. Good night. See you.
Thank you so much.
Friday. Thanks, guys. Thank you.